I'm Maria, and I've been using Qiskit to understand quantum paradoxes. Today, I'm going to explain Hardy's paradox, which shows how our classical reasoning breaks down for entangled particles. The paradox was proposed to demonstrate a new type of quantum spooky action at a distance, also known as non-locality, in a different way to Bell inequalities. I've created a quantum lie detector using Qiskit to find out exactly where our classical reasoning goes wrong. Let's play a game of two quantum truths and a lie. Imagine I have two entangled qubits in the joint state 00 plus 01 plus 10, and I give one to Alice and one to Bob. Then Carol tells us three statements about the outcomes that Alice and Bob will get when they measure their qubits. Two of these are true and one is a lie. I'm going to use my quantum lie detector to check each of Carol's statements. Here is the code for my quantum lie detector. I can input whether Alice and Bob measure their qubits in the x basis or the z basis, and then a measurement outcome that Carol thinks should be forbidden. Now I can check Carol's statement number one. If Alice and Bob both measure their qubits in the Z basis, then the outcome 1-1 is forbidden. So I'll type Z for the basis Alice measures in, Z for Bob, 1-1 state is forbidden, and this statement was true. Now I'll check Carol's statement number two. If Alice measures her qubit in the Z basis and Bob measures his in the X basis, then the outcome 0 minus is forbidden, and vice versa. If Bob measures in Z and Alice measures in X, then minus 0 is forbidden. Now in my lie detector, a X measurement on the state plus will give a 0 outcome, and an X measurement on minus will give a 1 outcome. So let's check these statements. If Alice measures in Z, Bob measures in X, then 0, 1 is forbidden. And this is true. And the other statement, if Alice measures in X and Bob measures in Z, then 1-0 never occurs. And this is also true. So now let's check Carol's statement number three. If Alice and Bob both measure their qubits in the X basis, then the outcome minus minus will never occur. Now minus minus corresponds to 1-1 in my lie detector. So let's try this. Alice measures in X, Bob measures in X, and 1-1 never occurs. And this was a lie. Carol's quantum lie is at the root of Hardy's paradox. Hardy's paradox was proposed in 1992, and since then it has been implemented experimentally, and many different interpretations of the paradox have been proposed. It demonstrates the counterintuitive nature of quantum logic. Since classical reasoning would actually lead us to believe that Carol's third statement is true. Some think the apparent paradox is a simple consequence of entanglement, and others that it's a really surprising feature of quantum theory. Now you can decide for yourself. I'm going to explain how Hardy's original paradox maps on to Carol's three statements, and how these can be translated to quantum circuits that I use to build my quantum lie detector. Hardy's original thought experiment involved two overlapping interferometers, which can split a particle into a superposition of states and then merge it back into one state again. Now we send a particle through one interferometer and an antiparticle through the other. Where the interferometers overlap, the particle and antiparticle will annihilate each other and not be detected at the end. Now Hardy realised that there is a finite chance of getting a measurement outcome at the end, which seems to suggest that the particle and antiparticle went down the same path, but without annihilating each other. This should be impossible. We can represent the particle and antiparticle as qubits, where 0 represents one path down the interferometer and 1 represents the other path. Then we need to have a term in the joint state of the qubits missing to correspond to the particle and antiparticle going down the same path and annihilating each other. Let's say this is the 1-1 term. Then before the qubits are measured, they end up in the 0,0 plus 0,1 plus 1,0 state. We can create this state using the initialize method in Qiskit. So here we can see that we can create our entangled state with a mixture of Z rotation, root X gates, and controlled NOT gates. Now we give the first particle qubit to Alice and the second antiparticle qubit to Bob. Then Carol's first statement is that if Alice and Bob both measure their qubits in the Z basis, at least one of them will measure zero. We can see this directly from the quantum state, 0,0 plus 0,1 plus 1,0. But we can also see it if we run our quantum circuit. Then you can see on this histogram that there's no 1,1 outcome. So Carol's second statement is that if Alice measures zero, then Bob will definitely measure plus. And if Bob measures zero, then Alice will definitely measure plus. We can see that this is true because of how we can rewrite the quantum state. We can write the state as 0 plus plus 1, 0, so that if Alice measures 0, Bob definitely gets plus, or as plus 0 plus 0, 1, which means that if Bob measures 0, Alice will always get plus. So let's check this with a quantum circuit. We now need Alice to measure in the Z basis and Bob to measure in the X basis. So we add a Hadamard gate before Bob's Z measurement to turn it into an X measurement. Then we can run this circuit, and we see that the 0,1 outcome is forbidden as predicted. And then we check the reverse. This time Alice measures in the X basis and has a Hadamard gate before her Z measurement. And then we see the outcome, and we see that 1,0 is forbidden, which is correct with Carol's statement. Now what happens if we put these two quantum circuits together? We know that if Alice and Bob both measure their qubits in the Z basis, at least one of them will get zero. And if one of them measures zero in the Z basis, the other one will definitely get plus. Classical Carol's intuitive conclusion was that at least one of Alice and Bob must get plus if they both measure in the X basis. Well, let's test this out with a quantum circuit. If Alice and Bob both measure in the X basis, then they both need a Hadamard gate before their Z measurement. And we can run this to see if the outcome minus minus is forbidden, as Carol said. And we can see we have a problem. There is some chance that we measure the outcome 1,1, corresponding to minus minus, which contradicts Carol's conclusion. This contradiction has drastic physical consequences for Hardy's original thought experiment. According to classical Carol, Alice and Bob could only get minus minus if neither Alice nor Bob would have measured zero if they had measured their qubits in the Z basis. This implies that the qubits were in the 1,1 state, which we said corresponds to a particle and antiparticle having gone down the same path, which is impossible. They should have annihilated each other. Hardy pointed out that Carol made an important classical assumption when she deduced that at least one of Alice and Bob would measure a plus. She assumed that Alice measuring her qubit would make no difference to Bob's qubit, which would be true classically. An alternative is that Alice choosing to make a Z or X basis measurement on her qubit actually has an effect on Bob's measurement outcomes, and vice versa. So, if Alice and Bob never actually made their Z basis measurements, then neither of them can conclude that the other one's qubit must be in the plus state. So one possible resolution to the paradox is to accept that quantum theory must be non-local. The choice of measurement basis on Alice's qubit has some kind of effect on Bob's distant entangled qubit. But importantly, this can't be used to send information faster than light, which would violate special relativity. Hardy's paradox also reveals a surprising difference between entanglement and non-locality. It turns out that the paradox can be constructed for almost all entangled state, except maximally entangled ones. So more entanglement doesn't always correspond to more non-locality. fully understanding the different roles that entanglement and non-locality play in boosting quantum information processing power is an intriguing open problem. So our game of two quantum truths and a lie reveals some strange quantum truths about non-locality. And it doesn't just work for the special entangled state that I used in my game, but for almost any two entangled qubits. Can you create your own quantum lie detector to tell the difference between two quantum truths and a classically convincing lie? Let us know what you come up with in the comments. Thanks for watching and see you next time.